Welcome to NOAA Live Alaska. My name is Lisa Hiruki-Raring and I'm going to be moderating today's webinar. This series is a collaborative effort by NOAA Fisheries Alaska Fisheries Science Center, where I work, NOAA's Alaska Regional Collaboration Network, and NOAA's National Weather Service. This webinar series is designed to help you get to know NOAA's work in Alaska and how we connect and work with your communities. NOAA, the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration, studies the ocean and the atmosphere and where to meet, from weather to ocean to the animals that live around us. All of our speakers work for some part of NOAA or work in partnership with NOAA. We hope this gives you a sneak peek at different career paths you're interested in. This school year, we're presenting a short series of webinars. We're presenting a series of short series of webinars that are more regionally based so that we can focus on topics of interest to those regions of Alaska. And we're also aiming to present research conducted by students as well as established scientists. And that's one of our presentations today. We're introducing you to Coral Pazzi, who did her graduate research on beluga whales at Alaska Pacific University and currently works for the Washington Department of Fish and Wildlife. While we'll be talking about NOAA's role in research and stewardship, we want to recognize that we're all coming to you from the traditional lands of Native communities who have substantial traditional and local knowledge and much to share with us. We acknowledge that Coral's graduate research was done in Bristol Bay, Alaska, the traditional lands of the Yupik, Denaina, and Malupik people who have stewarded their lands and waters for thousands of years. Coral is currently stationed in Olympia, Washington, and is presenting this webinar from a field location on the Columbia River. We'd like to acknowledge that Coral's current research is done throughout the Puget Sound area in the Salish Sea, the traditional lands of post-Salish tribes who have lived in this area and cared for the land and waters since time immemorial. We're hosting this webinar from the traditional lands of the First People of Seattle, the Duwamish people, past and present. A few guidelines before I hand you over to our speaker. You're all muted because we have a lot of people on the line and we want to make sure that everyone can hear our speaker. However, there's a box where you can write questions and we encourage you to ask them as we go. And my colleagues, Story Oates, Mabel Baldwin Schaefer, and I will be keeping track of these questions for Coral. She'll stop every now and again and answer a few questions. We might not get to all of our questions, but we'll try to answer as many as we can. Okay, I'll hand it over to Coral to introduce herself.
Hey, thank you, Lisa. Hi, everyone. My name is Coral Pazzi, and like she said, I'm going to be talking a little bit about the work I did for my master's degree up in Alaska and about kind of how I got to where I am now here in Washington with Washington Department of Fish and Wildlife. So, to start off, why this work? How did I get into this field? And really, it's just because I've always loved being outdoors. My mom said she would have to stop me from jumping into pools before I even had, you know, swimmies on. I just wanted to be in the water. I wanted to be outdoors all the time. And in the picture you see of the otter suit, that's me at a volunteer event for my mother who worked for Department of Conservation and Natural Resources in Pennsylvania. And it was a really hot otter suit, by the way. And I also was, like I said, always out on the water, and that's a picture of me sculling, but I knew I wanted to work with animals as well in some way. So when I decided I wanted to do work with ocean, I thought, let's focus on mammals, so marine mammals specifically. And that's how I got to my degree in Alaska, where I was able to get a position in a master's lab there working on beluga whales. So a little background about beluga whales. Some of you may already know some of this, but just a quick little note, they can live upwards of 30 years. Males tend to be a bit bigger than females by on average about 1,000 pounds and a little bit longer by about a foot. All in all, they look pretty similar, but when they're born, they tend to be a darker gray. And when they reach maturity, for females around 7 years and for males around 9 years, they get that distinct pure white look that we all pretty much know when you think of beluga whales. As far as behavior, they're extremely social animals, so they're usually found in groups of 2 to 3 to several hundred. As far as what they eat, they're pretty opportunistic feeders, which basically means they'll eat whatever they can get, sometimes like me. But for them, they'll eat all sorts of fishes, squids, crabs, octopus, and other marine invertebrates. Over here, I have a picture of some ulacan up at the top there, then Alaska salmon, and also a great Pacific octopus. So belugas are pretty cool because they're circumpolar in their distribution, which basically means they inhabit one of the Earth's poles. And for belugas, they're around the Arctic and subarctic. So they're in Russia, Greenland, and the North America. And in the United States, there are five distinct stocks, and they're all located in Alaska. And they are in Cook Inlet, Bristol Bay, Eastern Bering Sea, Eastern Chukchi Sea, and the Beaufort Sea. And when we say stocks, we're referring to basically like subpopulations of that species. So of those five stocks, Cook Inlet is the only one that's actually endangered, and it's been listed as endangered since October of 2008. They're the most isolated stock, which we determined via genetic sampling, and they have severely reduced numbers in the last several decades. From the late 1970s, there were around 1,300, to the most up-to-date estimate in 2018 of about 279 beluga whales in the Cook Inlet. And just to give you an idea, when I was working on my project back in 2013, we had an estimate out of about 325. So just within the 5 years from that 2013 to 2018, there's been a pretty decent size drop. Unfortunately, it's not really certain why they're declining, but there are a lot of factors as to why that could be. So potentially parasites and disease, predation from killer whales, illegal harvesting, pollution, environmental changes, coastal development, and commercial and personal use of beluga's food source, so potential declines in fish runs. And for my project, we kind of wanted to look at that last one, because if for some reason their prey is scarce and it's the primary reason for their lack of recovery, it's important to study their available energy. And this can be observed by studying an animal's blubber volume and caloric content. So when they feed during those summer months, it helps them lay down blubber stores for winter months when potentially prey is less available. So right now I'm gonna go ahead and take a little mini break and ask, see if anyone has any questions so far. And also get a sip of water.
So Coral, so for those of you in the audience, if you have any questions for Coral about what she's just talked about with regard to Cook Inlet beluga whales, go ahead and put your questions into the question box. We did have some questions that came up. I had some folks who were interested in that decline that you, that since you were working on belugas in 2013, you said that there were 325. Mm-hmm. And now there are less than, there are even less than 300. And that seems like a big drop in just 5 years. Is that kind of a drop the way that it's been declining all the time, or does it go in little, does it decline a little bit at a time?
It's been more of a steady decline a little bit at a time. So that is a pretty sharp decline. And unfortunately, once I graduated and finished my project in around 2014, I continue work with beluga whales. So I'm not entirely sure if any more has come from that as far as seeing specifics, but it's typically a pretty steady but shorter decline. So if that answers that, I hope.
And we also got a question of how Kevin had wanted, one of Kevin's students had wanted to know, what was the oldest whale that you had found that you were looking at? And perhaps this is just a general question of whether you know what the oldest beluga whale that's been found has been.
So I don't know off the top of my head what the oldest whale was found. And unfortunately for when we were doing our work, I don't believe we took ages, and usually you can kind of get age by doing like teeth identification. You can take the teeth and you can send them to a lab and they can kind of get an idea of how old they are. Kind of like you do with tree rings, kind of similar. But I didn't get anything. I just had whether or not they were adults or juveniles when I did work with them. So unfortunately, I'm sorry, I don't have a really good answer for that one.
Well, I know from our webinar that we did on Friday that the oldest whale that they had samples from in that study was 28. And I was thinking that maybe I noticed that there were some folks on the line who have done work on on belugas. So perhaps one of them might be able to chime in a little bit later on with whether there are, have been other belugas that have been found that have been older. I have, Michelle also had a question. She was asking, do males and females have the same life expectancies?
I believe so. I'm not 100% sure on that, to be honest. I do think that they can live similar lengths. I do think that upwards of 30 is a general for both.
And I think that one of our beluga folks, Kim Sheldon, has typed in that we have had a beluga as old as 70 years old in other populations, but in Cook Inlet, the oldest that they found was 49 years. So that's very interesting. And then Maris had said that there are belugas in aquariums who are over 50 years old. So it sounds like they can get to be quite old. I had not realized that belugas could go up to 70 years old. So that's very interesting. Okay, well, maybe we should go on to your next section to talk about your study.
Sure. Before I move on to my next slide, I actually have a question for you guys. If anyone can tell me what blubber is, since that's what I'm about to get into.
Yeah, so what Coral is going to be talking about is what blubber can tell us. But first of all, we wanted to see what your guys' thoughts were on what blubber actually is. So if you have a guess to say what blubber might be, you can type it in. And several people, Kevin and his students, Alicia and Tavi and Sophia from Kodiak are saying fat. Michelle is saying whale fat. Zhao is saying fat. So a lot of people are saying fat. So what is blubber actually fat, or is there any difference there?
That's definitely a really good response. So it's the definition is it's a layer of vascularized adipose tissue, which is known as fat, found under the skin of most marine mammals.
So just to cut in there, Coral, what does vascularized mean?
Oh, so it just basically means that it can be, it gets blood, it has more blood pumping towards it.
Okay, so it's like it's fat tissue that has blood vessels in it?
Yes. Great. Okay. But it's not like our fat. It's actually a little bit more useful for, it has more uses for marine mammals than our fat does for it, for us. And even though we can use our fat for energy, like I said, this fat has a lot of structural and, or blubber has a lot of structural and physiological functions. One of the big ones is it really helps with insulation. And that's really important for beluga whales since they're in the Arctic in those cold waters. And it also helps them with streamlining, which means when they're swimming, it's easier for them. It's less energy usage when they're swimming if they have good blubber. Helps with buoyancy. Like I said, it's also for energy reserves. And it's just a really good overall health indicator typically. It's a big part of the entire of the animal's body mass. And if those stores are depleted, they can decrease the thermoregulatory control. And that basically means their ability to moderate their body temperature. And it also can decrease their swimming efficiency and basically their overall survivorship.
So, Coral, when you're saying that it can affect how they can control their body temperature, does that mean that when they have more blubber, they can keep warmer?
Yes.
And it helps with the buffer against blubber. If they have less blubber, then they can't stay as warm.
Exactly. And especially in those Arctic waters, that's a pretty big deal. So for my project, I kind of had two things I was looking at. The first one was just to kind of look at two methods of determining the total body blubber stores on an animal. So that's the proportion of estimated body mass. And then we also, the biggest one was looking at ultrasound depth measurements, which I'll get into here in a minute. And then the second thing we really wanted to do once we figured that out was to determine if blubber mass, so the amount of that blubber on the body, was significantly different between seasons and age class. So if it was different between fall and spring and between adults and juveniles. So I'll get into that here. So for the sampling that was done, it was done before I got up there. So unfortunately, most of my data had already been collected by another team. And everybody here in the pictures was the team that captured live animals in Bristol Bay, all under a permit per NOAA's request. and requirements for the safety of the animals and the people involved. And they passively restrained them and made sure to work quickly to ensure less stress on the animal. And overall, we took measurements along the entire body using high resolution ultrasound, and also took blubber biopsies. And we compared both of those to determine if high resolution ultrasound was a good measurement to get a good idea of how deep the blubber was. So we could do that instead of constantly having to do biopsies, because biopsies are pretty invasive. And that means biopsies basically mean taking an actual small like depth puncture to get an idea of how deep it is. And ultrasound, does anyone know what ultrasound is? Can anyone give me an idea?
So if you think you know what ultrasound might be, you can type it into the question box. It sounds like folks are saying that ultrasound is something that people use to look at things inside the body. Michelle is saying that it's kind of like X-rays. Someone else is saying that it's what people use to look at babies that are inside pregnant women. So it sounds like it's not exactly the same as X-ray, I don't think. So maybe you could explain the difference there.
Yeah, so X-rays take a picture of kind of, you know, what they can see within an animal or a person, or I guess in that sense. And not everything always shows up on X-rays based on its density. Ultrasounds can be a good way to see kind of a movement picture. So like you said, like somebody who said regarding, you know, seeing a baby in their mom's stomach, you can get a heartbeat from that as well. So you get a little bit more of a movement picture from that. And again, the ultrasound machine is a better way to get that depth measurement than an X-ray. So we did ultrasound measurements over all along the body, and we didn't just do one spot on the animal, because for instance, if you were to take a measurement on your arm, it wouldn't be a really good representation of a measurement on your leg. So blubber varies along the body. So we had to do it at a couple different spots, which I'll get into in a little bit. Found that the measurements were almost equal. So ultrasound was a good way to use a less alternative method to measure that blubber depth. And so for my project, blubber depth had been measured on 11 locations, as you can see in the picture of the beluga whale there. We took 5 on top, 5 on the side, and then 1 at the axillary girth, which is kind of where you would think the armpit is on the animal. And we did those on 21 beluga whales in Bristol Bay, Alaska. And then we double checked our measurements to make sure they were correct, and to double check that ultrasound, you know, was still the best way to do this, and used it and compared that with physical measurements from subsistence harvests in Point Lay, Alaska. And then we calculated those total body blubber stores on the animal, like I said, so that we could determine how much blubber was on every animal. And then we compared between the fall and spring and between adults and juveniles. And just a quick little thing, we found that adults had lower stores in the spring than in the fall, but there was no significant difference for juveniles. But why did I use Bristol Bay animals when, you know, we were talking about Cook Inlet being the endangered stock, right? Well, unfortunately, because Cook Inlet whales are endangered, it was really hard for us to try to get a permit to actually work with them physically, because you didn't want to harm them or cause any more decline unnecessarily or any stress to that population. Luckily, Bristol Bay stock has a pretty similar life history as the Cook Inlet beluga whales. So we thought, okay, if we study on the Bristol Bay population, we can potentially use that information as a starter to kind of see if it's affecting Cook Inlet in the same way. So like I said, we found that blubber stores were greater in the fall compared to the spring, which means they were probably using the samples that they'd, or the blubber they'd stored up by the fall time to get them through the winter, potentially if prey was scarce. And adults had a greater blubber stores than juveniles, and there was no seasonal difference for those juveniles. And there are possibly serious implications for the Cook Inlet belugas. And that's because for juveniles, They tend to lose heat faster than larger adults, and so they require more blubber to assist in that thermoregulation I was talking about before, that body temperature regulation, and protect against that heat loss. And the fact that there were greater stores in the fall for adults supports the idea that belugas probably have less prey available in the winter. And the reason we don't know what their prey is during the winter, they tend to swim into deeper water, so it's harder for us to get an idea of what they're doing during that time. And they could also be using those stores during the winter to survive to make it to spring. However, for juveniles, this is different. And since there was no significant difference, it suggests that their energy from the blubber is actually put towards growth instead of blubber accumulation over that winter. So it could mean that, you know, if for some reason they aren't able to eat enough, juveniles might not be able to make it through the winter, and so they might die off, and that could be a reason for the decline. So that was kind of our preliminary findings after my thesis. So I just want to see if anyone has any questions real quick here before we move on.
I was a little curious about, so when you were saying that adults have higher blubber measurements in the fall compared to in the spring, that were you saying that the adults were sort of storing up all of the food that they ate through the summer as blubber, so that they had, it's sort of like how chipmunks, you know, eat nuts and stuff over the summer, and then they're really fat when they go into the winter? Is that sort of like what the adults Yes. are doing?
Yeah, that's a really good description of it. Yeah.
And then so what you were saying with the juveniles was that because there wasn't any difference between their fat stores in the spring and in the fall, they weren't storing that food that they were eating through the summer.
They were more focused on growing, you know, trying right. to get to adult size in that, you know, time. So unfortunately, they didn't have enough blubber stores to really get them to the spring sometimes.
So what would be the next step in looking at the information on the juveniles to figure out whether that fat storage does have an impact? Would you or somebody else be looking at whether juveniles survive to the next year?
Yeah, so if possible, it would be a really good way to kind of tag individuals if, you know, ideally without, you know, having to worry about too much. It would be nice to be able to make sure you got the same individual and followed them for a few years, maybe potentially for, you know, from calf when birth on, to kind of see how that, if it fluctuates. If you can get more than just 1 year of, or one season's worth of data, it's, you know, better to have more data than less when it comes to trying to figure these kinds of things out. So that would be, you know, a nice next step. And also, you know, ideally, it's understandable why we weren't able to work on the Cook Inlet beluga whales, why we weren't able to get a permit for that, completely respect that. But it would be really cool to ideally get to actually study them specifically to see if the same trends do occur.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, very interesting. So Kevin and his students from Akatan were wondering, do Bristol Bay belugas have more or less food available? Or can you, is there a way to determine that? I guess more or less food available than Cook Inlet belugas?
You know, to be completely honest, I'm not sure at this point. I'm not sure what the fish runs are like up there. Like I said, they're all mostly opportunistic feeders, but I'm not sure currently how the fish runs have changed up in Alaska. Maybe one of the other, if anyone from Alaska who works with the fish up there, especially salmon, knows anything, if they could chime in, that would be really helpful. But I'm not 100% sure if they have more options than Cook Inlet. My guess is yes, but I'm not 100% sure. I'm sorry.
But Kevin has brought up a really interesting question, in that those are the kinds of questions I think that are generated by a study like yours, where this would be the next step that people would take, is to ask the question, what's the food like in the two populations, and how would you follow up on that? So I appreciate your guys' question. And I think that one of the ways that you could follow up on that is I think that there's probably information on the NOAA Fisheries website about the different stocks of beluga populations. And so you might be able to get an idea of that, of the answer to your question by looking it up on the NOAA website.
Yeah, NOAA's website is full of wonderful information. It was very helpful when I was working on my project back then as well, and looking for primary sources for my paper, so.
And then Maris was wondering, are you able to share the maximum blubber thickness that you measured?
Ooh.
Have those results been published?
Yes, so there is a publication. I can probably pull it up on my other laptop. I don't want to exit out of this screen. That was part of a larger publication under my advisor, Dr. Leslie Cornick at APU. She is no longer there. She's moved to Washington, but the paper was estimating seasonal blubber stores in beluga whales. And honestly, if you Google Scholar, my name and beluga whale blubber, that will likely pop up for you.
And Maris, we can also send you the link to the paper after the webinar. So that would be another way. Well, great. I think that's all the questions that we have for now. So if you'd like to go on to your next section.
Okay, so after I graduated, I wasn't really sure where I wanted to go.
Uh-oh. Hey, Coral, I think that we have lost your connection here. So it sounds like Coral's connection might have been lost a little bit. I will try to get in touch with her and see whether we can bring it up again. So please hold on with us for just a second here. So while we're waiting for Coral to come back in again, we can see whether we have any other questions that have come up. I see that for Maris that we've sent you the link to the paper that Coral was talking about. So one of the things that came up from our webinar earlier on Friday is that our Paul Wade had talked about different ways to age beluga whales. And so one of the ways that we were talking about how to figure out how old a beluga whale was that we were looking at the ages by looking at rings in the teeth and counting the rings in the teeth to find out how old the whales are. But one of the new ways that they were looking at with the belugas was by looking at tissue samples and looking at chemical ways of trying to figure out how old a whale is. So some of those new ways of determining age in whales has been really interesting in seeing how we can.
Can you hear me?
Yes, we can.
Hi, everybody. I don't know what happened with the internet connection here.
Yeah. No, I'm glad that you were able to come back and go out and come back in, and I think we're all set. I was just updating the audience on some of our new ways of determining age in belugas.
So okay, wonderful.
Glad to have you back.
Okay, I think I need you to make me the presenter again.
Okay, I will do so.
Sorry, everyone.
That's okay. So now you should be back again.
Let me get back in there and start that back up. Sorry, everyone. Okay. So I'm not sure where I got cut off, but I'll just start fresh on this one. So once I graduated, I didn't know really where I wanted to go, what my next step was going to be, because finding work in a marine mammal field is pretty limited. So I moved back home to Pennsylvania for a little bit and started working at the local vet. And in here, in the bottom left picture, you can see I just helped deliver an emergency C-section for a mastiff. She had 9 puppies. And then the other picture is a person's pet raccoon that they brought in, which was the first time I'd seen that. And she's on a harness and she was really sweet. They just warned you to hide any jewelry or anything shiny because she really likes that. So after I was working there for a little while, I realized that Pennsylvania was just landlocked, so not really the best place to try to find a job. And so I wanted to go back to the West Coast, and I was actually able to find a group called Cascadia Research Collective out here in Olympia. And they're really known for the work they do with whales. And so it they have a lot of unpaid internship opportunities. And so if you guys ever get to a point where you're really interested in doing stuff, I highly recommend checking them out. But a large part of their work is to do photo identification, do marine mammal branding response, and a lot of data management. And for the photo identification, they would have us interns. There are three of us in that bottom picture there on a really cold, windy day on a boat. Go out with whale tour boats that they're partnered with, and we would take the cameras and we would get pictures of, you know, specifically if humpbacks were in the area or gray whales were in the area, to do photo identification of individuals. And I actually have a video of a group of killer whales that we ran into. We didn't run into them. We were out on the water and they came up to us, and I'm going to pull up that video for you guys here. And hopefully everything goes smoothly. Okay, I'm gonna go ahead and play this.
And don't forget that you're muted right now, Coral.
Thank you, yes. And so yeah, they were just a really lively group that day. And so it's nice to be out on those boats. Typically though, when you're on the water with around any kind of marine mammal, you're supposed to stay at least like 100 feet away. But sometimes they swim right by you. So the boats usually will kind of just turn off and try not to cause any like noise issues or anything like that. Let's see if I can get out of that now. There we go. Okay, so once I was working, the other picture, actually, sorry, in the bottom right is of a stranded gray whale who, if you can see, obviously got through some entanglements, likely crab pot gear. Unfortunately, that's pretty popular out here. And when they strand, we go out and we do what's known as a necropsy on them to basically determine kind of cause of death and other health things with the animal for our data. And so a necropsy is basically like an autopsy, but on animals. And since it was an unpaid internship, I continued to work at the local emergency vet to, you know, help continue to keep, you know, my apartment and everything while out here until I could find another job that was still marine mammal related. So again, these are all nice photos from there, usually like happy animals that we were able to take care of. And another raccoon, oddly enough. Eventually, though, I was able to obtain my current position with Washington Department of Fish and Wildlife, and I've been with them for over 3.5 years now. And I was hired to do a variety of work. A large portion of my work is to do harbor seal diet studies to help with marine mammal stranding response and necropsies, to participate in aerial surveys for population counts, and also sea lion management issues. And so for diet studies, in the top photo there, that's myself and one of my coworkers out on one of the boat floats off of one of the islands collecting harbor seal scat. And can anyone tell me what scat is?
Okay, so there are probably some in our audience who have seen some of our other webinars that have to do with scat, but if you know what scat is, please put it into the chat. I see that Michelle is already giving it away. Michelle from Hawaii says that it's poop. Other people are saying that it's feces. It's it's what yep. comes out of the other end after animals have been eating.
Exactly. All of those answers are correct. And so we collect that to determine what are they eating, how they might be impacting local fish species and other invertebrate species. And we separate that for DNA and hard parts. And we send off the DNA to go to the genetics lab here to be run. And then we sift through the hard parts, which you see me doing with one of my coworkers' daughters in that bottom left photo there. And you separate like the ear bones with other bones, and you put them in all those tiny vials, which you see in the bottom right corner. And then we send those off to our expert who IDs them. And then we compare that data and see, you know, how well the genetics and the hard parts line up to what it's saying they're eating. Another thing that I get to help with a lot is the our marine mammal strandings. And we have a lot of animals in the area, so like harbor seals, California and Stellar sea lions, elephant seals, sea otters, sometimes northern fur seals and Guadalupe fur seals. And we also help out with Cascadia Research Collective and doing a lot of whale stuff as well. And all of the pictures you're seeing, especially me handling these animals, are all because my job is under permits that we are allowed to do this. Otherwise, we do not recommend handling marine mammals. They're pretty, they can be aggressive and potentially dangerous. So this is all under permitting. That first photo there is actually a harbor seal pup that we did rescue. It had been abandoned sometimes during the pupping season, which is usually, you know, probably June to now-ish. We get a lot of calls regarding harbor seal pups in the area. And we go out and usually we just monitor and the mom's probably around. We just tell people to leave them alone. You know, otherwise the mom won't come back if you get too close to the baby. So if you're ever around them, stay away from them, but do let us know they're there. And this one we rescued and sent off to rehabilitation, which is basically sending them off to a doctor who can, you know, take care of them until they're ready to re-release them into the wild. Other times we, like I said, we work on California or Stellar sea lions. And that bottom right photo is a California sea lion that we got a call about up in Seattle, who had been hanging out on a pretty popular beach, Alki Beach, if any of you know the area. And it was a little aggressive, but it also didn't look like it was doing very well. And if you can see the photo, if you look a little closer, you can see its ribs on the right side of it. So it wasn't really able to feed. We monitored it for a few days and eventually decided to remove it. So we got it onto a boat into a trap and we took it back to our lab. And after assessment, we decided we needed to euthanize it. Unfortunately, it wasn't a good candidate for rehabilitation. And when we did the necropsy on it, we found that it had a lot of cancer in it. So it was the right call to make. And they're tough calls to make, but sometimes we have to do that. And then the photo in the top right corner is actually an elephant seal. And anytime they show up, if they're molting, we get a lot of calls about them because when they molt, which basically means, you know, they're kind of shedding that layer of fur, they do not look good. They look very, they're messy when they molt. So people are concerned that they're injured or, you know, dying. So we get a lot of calls about that one, but that one was okay. She survived and just left after. We just tell people to leave them alone. But we do, you know, ask for people to report them in if need be. So that's a large portion of what I do as well. Another thing that I get to be a part of are our aerial surveys, which is really cool. We're usually in these small 4 to 6 person planes typically, and we fly all around the Puget Sound and along the coast to mostly do harbor seal population counts. In the bottom right photo, it's a little hard to see, but there are a bunch of kind of white gray dots all along the bottom of the island there on the left side, and those are all harbor seals actually. And so we will circle those haul out sites, which is where they haul out of the water when they're not swimming and laying on land, and we take photos. And then when we get back, we tend to look at those photos to actually get a count of how many animals are there. In the top right photo, that's actually a raft of sea otters from one of our flights, and they're called a raft because they like to kind of hold hands and raft together. They're always in these large groups typically. And then in the bottom left photo, that's actually a bunch of California sea lions hanging out on that that bit of jetty rock. And then, like Lisa said, I'm actually down on the Columbia River right now, helping with sea lion management at Bonneville Dam. And that's where we do a variety of work down here, but a large portion of it is to protect salmon runs. And in the top left photo there, you actually see myself and one of my coworkers, Shayana. We've trapped a sea lion and we need to anesthetize it, so kind of knock it out a little bit. And so we had to use a traffic cone that's big enough to get over their big faces to, you know, kind of administer the anesthesia gas. And then in the bottom right photo, you'll see where we have branded it. And the branding is pretty painless. They have really thick skin. And whenever we brand, it usually just burns through the fur and like a little bit of a layer, and it doesn't really get nerves. So the most uncomfortable portion of it is when they're in the squeeze cage, which you can kind of see in that photo. And it's kind of got these bars that when they get in there, we push them down, so it just kind of holds them so they can't move around too much, so it's not, so they don't hurt themselves while we do that. And then in the top right corner, I'm going to go ahead and play a video of us re-releasing it. That way we can monitor it and see what animal is doing what, since we can actually see which one is individualized.
Don't forget that you're muted, Coral.
I keep forgetting that. Sorry, everyone. So this is a nice windy day. That's me on top there, removing a crowder board. And those are usually in there so that when we're driving, they can't see out back, and it, you know, kind of doesn't stress them out. It's a little sticky of a gate, but I get it up there, and it flops out here in a minute. Just kind of looks a little surprised at us, and starts to go the wrong direction. The video cuts out here in a minute, but it eventually realizes it needs to go left and goes back into the water. And then, let's get back to screen. And then last but not least, I have two other little videos of things that we sometimes come across. So the video on the right is gonna be a bunch of California sea lions that we come across when we're out on the water in Cars Inlet in the Puget Sound. And we just came across them when we were doing some other survey work. And we were really, really surprised to see how many were actually in the area. But the video I'm gonna show, we'll pull that on up here. I will remember that I will to unmute myself. There we go. And as you can see, there's a bunch just popping up kind of all along the water there. And it was really interesting because when we first got out there, it was just like glass. You had no clue there were that many animals out there. And then they would all come up. So likely they were underwater feeding on what's known as a bait ball, which is like a group of fish, likely herring in this case. And they all go down. They're all, you know, chasing and feeding, and then they all come up to the top. So that was really cool to come across out there. And then the second video is actually a group of common dolphins who were in the same area. And it was really interesting. This is them bow riding, which is a really common thing for dolphins to do. They are safe. They basically use the speed from our boat to kind of get an extra speed as well. So there's really almost no risk of us hitting them. They're very agile on the water. But this was a really fun surprise to come across because common dolphins aren't that common here in the Puget Sound, actually. But yeah, they're really playful, and apparently it's a pretty fun thing for them to get to do. So. And it was very fun for us to see. So yeah, those are a lot of things that we do in my work. Let's get out of there. So at this point, I'll just open it up and see if anyone has any questions or anything that they would like to ask now. I know that was a lot to throw at you.
All right, so Michelle was wondering, you had talked about doing necropsies of stranded marine mammals on the beach, and Michelle was wondering whether you do the necropsies right there on the beach.
Yes and no. So for whales, almost always. It's really hard to move them to do them anywhere in a lab because they're just so large. But for, you know, harbor seals, and sometimes for stellar sea lions or California sea lions, if we can, if there are enough of us, we can go ahead and move them and do that at our lab and at our office. So I would say probably half and half, depending on what the animal is.
And another question is, how long does it take to do a necropsy?
Again, dependent on the animal, but a whale can take a good portion of the day, especially if you want to get all the samples possible. And it usually takes a good number of people involved. So that's why we help out with Cascadia, because, you know, it's nice to have the extra hands. And like I said, I was able to help out with them as an intern, but I still help out with them as my current position. So that can take a whole day. If you're doing a smaller animal, you know, you could, and depending on what samples you want to get, you can probably do it in an hour to 2 hours.
Okay, and then you had talked about taking samples. What kind of samples do you take and what can you find out from them?
Oh goodness, all sorts of things. So, you know, often we want to know what the cause of death is, because potentially, you know, especially if there's a lot of deaths of a specific species kind of showing up, there could be some kind of disease going between there. So we'll take a lot of blood samples. We'll take, you know, basically samples of different organs. So like lungs or heart, and you always kind of check the heart for heartworms, or lungs for any kind of weird splotches, or kidneys to see, you know, just anything that's off with those can point to different things. And, you know, there's, you know, brucellus, there's a lot of things that can be transferred between like different species as well. So we just sample a majority of all of the organs you might think of, and blood work. And we also check the brain out too, which is pretty cool sometimes. But we wear protected gear, because there are some things that can jump between humans and animals. So you just want to make sure you're always protected when you do that.
Right. The other question that we had was, do you look at the stomachs of animals that you find on the beach?
Sometimes, yeah. If we're trying to do a pretty thorough necropsy, then yes, we do tend to check, you know, the stomach contents to see what they're eating. Sometimes there's nothing in there, and that can be a sign that they haven't been eating, and, you know, potentially something else has caused them to be sick so that they haven't been able to eat. Other times it's pretty full, so that's probably, so, you know, malnutrition probably isn't the cause of death, but, you know, we will look at all of that. And sometimes there was even a time where we had a harbor porpoise that stranded, and when we did the necropsy, we found a whole fish stuck in its throat. So unfortunately, it looked like it had tried to be feeding on something that was just too big for it to eat, and it didn't end well for it. But that was a very interesting find.
Huh, that's very interesting, yeah. You had also mentioned that with that California sea lion that you had the picture of, that when you did the necropsy on it, you found cancer in it.
Yes.
How could you tell that? Was it just tumors, like growths inside?
A lot of that, and without being too graphic, it just looked like a lot of cottage cheese throughout the body cavity. I, you know, did not put a picture of that on there because it's pretty, you know, it's a little gross, but it was pretty noticeable just because it was basically from the chest down to, you know, its groin area, just filled with it.
Well, that's interesting, because a lot of the, you know, we think about our pets getting cancer, but you don't really think about cancer in wild animals as much.
Yeah.
Alice had wondered, has any COVID been found in marine mammals?
I'm not 100% sure, but we actually were taking swabs down here on work that we were doing with Stellar and California sea lions. We did some samples in the spring where we were doing nasal swabs and rectal swabs to test for that. So those have been sent out. I don't know if they've been run or any results have come back yet on that, because labs get pretty backed up sometimes. So sometimes you don't get your results as soon as you would hope. I do not know if that has been found yet, but we are testing for it.
So one of the other questions we had was, do you feel like the work that you did as a student on belugas helped you with getting the position that you have now?
I do think so. I think it helped me get my foot in the door with Cascadia Research Collective, and working with them helped me, you know, I started doing some volunteer work with WDFW as well, because, you know, we partnered on necropsy things. And then when the position opened up, I had gained that experience and I had the degree. So that did help. I do think so.
Because a lot of the times, you know, people, especially students, when they're talking to scientists about how they got to be doing what they're doing, it feels like everything, you know, moves naturally from one thing to the next when you look at it in hindsight. But in your case, you know, you would put into your presentation that you had some times where you had gone back to your hometown and were working as a veterinarian while you were trying to figure out what your next step was. And I think that those times are important as well in terms of figuring out what you really want to do.
Yeah, I think it's a really good idea to take a step back sometimes and just really think, especially after, you know, I just finished my master's, I was honestly a little burnt out because it's a lot of work to get to that point. And I just needed to take a little bit of a breather and figure out where I wanted to go next and where I wanted to live, because I loved Alaska, but I was kind of ready for the next step. I just didn't know what that step was going to be. And, you know, I knew I could still work at the vet and kind of keep up my medical side of things a little bit. So it was a good way to keep working with animals, keep doing things I enjoyed, but was able to eventually get back to the marine mammal side. But it took a while, and it was, you know, a lot of juggling of different things. But, you know, internships are, if you can get them, are really helpful. A lot of them are unpaid, so you kind of do have to figure out, you know, what you can do, what you can afford to do. And that's probably the hardest part, but hopefully that makes some changes in the near future.
That's right. Yeah, that's one of the conversations that is going on in a lot of different fields, is the difference between unpaid and paid internships. Jenna was wondering, did you prefer the research you did on belugas or the work that you do now on pinnipeds like seals and sea lions?
You know, it's really hard. I have a special place in my heart for beluga whales, and if I had the opportunity to go back and do more work on them, I'm pretty sure I would. But then when I, like I had said previously, a lot of my data had already been collected, so I didn't get to do a lot of the physical outdoor work, you know, with the animals, which is really where my passion is, just being out in the field. My current position is probably about half and half, and typically when COVID isn't an issue, it's more 75 and 25, where I'm out in the field 75% of the time collecting data, you know, doing all of the survey stuff or helping with strandings, and then 25% of actually managing the data, assessing it, you know, analyzing it, and kind of figuring out how that works for our management issues and things for the state. So, you know, as much as I love beluga whales, I have grown very fond of the pinnipeds, the harbor seals, and sea lions in our area, for sure.
Great. And Kevin and his students had one question about back to belugas, and they were wondering, do baby beluga whales eat fish?
So eventually they do, but they do still nurse off of their moms first. So, but they do eventually wean off and eat fish.
Great. Well, we're coming close to the end of our time, but I did wonder whether if you were to look back on your path to where you are now, what kind of advice would you give to middle and high schoolers in terms of, like, if they're interested in doing the types of work that you're doing now?
Yeah. Well, just know it is a lot of hard work. And it is really difficult to find a position in this field, especially because, you know, you need to be either by the water, or otherwise, if you're going to be in a state more landlocked, your really only options for marine mammal work are going to be more vet side or aquarium side of things. I would say just really, really make sure that it's what you're interested in. If you can do any kind of internship or job shadowing wherever you are currently, reach out, you know, see what your local, you know, opportunities are to maybe get the foot in the door now to figure out if it's something that you would be really interested in or not. And my email is on here, and I, you know, please feel free to reach out with any other questions that maybe come up, or if you want a little bit more discussion about that, I'm happy to do so. But I definitely just make sure it's something you're really passionate about, because it's a tough field to get into sometimes, but it's worth it if you love it.
Thank you so much, Coral, for sharing your project on belugas with us and your career path up till now. It's been very interesting information. And I also wanted to second Coral's offer to everybody to, if you want more information about opportunities that might be available, you can go ahead and contact her. You can also go ahead and contact me. My name is Lisa Hebrew-Key-Raring, and my email is on the NOAA Live Alaska website. And I really appreciate you taking the time to talk to us and our audience and share your information with us.
Yeah, it was a lot of fun. Thank you, everyone, for showing up and listening. And I hope I answered some questions, gave you some new information you didn't have before.
Great. Thank you very much. And stay tuned. We will send out more mailers when we do our next series of webinars. Thanks very much. Bye-bye.
Bye.